Hi, everyone. I'm Matt Clark, research analyst for Money and Markets. This is our weekly Marijuana Market Update. Remember, you can check out the Marijuana Market Update on our YouTube channel. Just head on over to youtube.com and search for Money and Markets, and you'll be the one with the green logo. Just find that, click it, and make sure you click the bell to get notified every time we put up a new video. Don't forget to give us feedback. You can always do that by emailing us at feedback@moneyandmarkets.com or leave a comment below in the comments section. We'd love to see what you have to say and love your feedback, and really do appreciate it. I was out last week due to a death in the family, but I'm back now, and I do want to answer some of your questions and respond to some of that really good feedback that we've gotten. We've got a ton, and I picked out a few. There was a lot I could have gone through, but limited amount of time, so I'll just pick out a few. But don't worry, I read everything that you guys write, and I really do appreciate it. I'm going to start with Randall, who emailed us, and he asked, do you foresee Aurora as a possible target for a buyout from a company that's much more stable and has the cash, such as Canopy? Basically, he's referring to Aurora Cannabis and whether it's a possibility that Aurora Cannabis could be bought out by a larger, more stable cannabis company like Canopy Growth. Well, it's a great question, Randall, and I do appreciate it. But I think we're a ways away from seeing any cannabis-to-cannabis company mergers of any significance. We'll see maybe some smaller ones, but big ones, I just really don't see that happening anytime in the near future. There's just too much uncertainty in the cannabis market right now to really justify a large cannabis company buying another large cannabis company. Canopy Growth Company, which trades on the New York Stock Exchange under CGC, they'd be undertaking a pretty significant bit of problems by buying up Aurora. First, there'd be the debt incurred from the merger, because I'm not really sure if Canopy would have enough cash on hand to make this an all-cash type of exchange without having to go to the bank and borrow some money. So there's going to be some debt incurred from that kind of a merger. And since cannabis companies already struggle to make a profit, incurring even more debt would make that light at the end of the tunnel, the debt tunnel, seem much farther away for a company like Canopy Growth, who's actually pretty close to maybe turning a profit here in the next 12, 18 to 24 months. And plus, what would really be the benefit to a company like cannabis to buy Aurora? I mean, basically, they're already in the same market. And Aurora's oversupply issue, as I explained in last week's update, I encourage you to check that out, or 2 weeks ago, rather, I encourage you to check that out. A company like Canopy would basically be buying into those problems. I'm not suggesting that Aurora couldn't be an acquisition target, but finances and the current market conditions tell me that now's really not the time for that to happen. If you remember, I asked you to email me why you're interested in Canopy stocks, and the feedback for that has been great. Chris emailed and asked about a pick and shovel play in the marijuana market. He specifically mentioned Neptune Wellness, which I'll have to do a little bit more thorough review on later. But he asks, he basically writes, I need a little time. I read a little into it, and it seems like kind of a business where marijuana plants are taken to have the THC extracted, cleaned, etc. I'm not sure how many businesses out there do this, but I was wondering if you would be able to shed any light on it. Being it's a cheap stock right now at roughly $2.50, and depending on how big the marijuana market industry grows, there might be some opportunity there. Let me know what you think. Well, thank you for your question, Chris, and I'll certainly do that. There aren't too many companies out there that you could really be considered as a pick and shovel play in the cannabis market. Most companies kind of go start to finish. They cultivate, they market, and sell their own brands, their own strains. So there's not a lot in the way of pick and shovel. But there are some companies out there that do provide services to the cannabis industry, like Neptune. However, I would caution you on one thing. The one thing I noticed is that you pointed out that it's a cheap stock at $2.50. And that's true. $2.50 is relatively cheap. But there are a lot of cheap stocks out there, and they're not even worth the low price, the low share price they're at. So I really caution you, and anyone really for that matter, on looking at an investment just on price alone, whether it be cannabis, whether it be a traditional stock, ETF, REITs, whatever. I would just really caution you on just looking at the price and saying, well, that's a good idea, I can buy into that. That doesn't necessarily make it a good buy for you. I'm not suggesting Neptune's one of them, because I haven't really looked into it that much. And I'm certainly going to now, because this has kind of sparked some interest for me. But you know, investors do make the mistake of investing in a company because the price is cheap. And share price is an element to buying stocks. It's not the only one. One of the last things I actually look at when I analyze a stock is its share price. I look at its momentum. I look at its value. I look at its quality. I look at a lot of other things before I even look at the share price. You know, the price is cheap to be sure. But why is it cheap? And that's a question you have to ask yourself. Why is it $2.50 a share? Perhaps it's overvalued, because you can actually be priced at $2.50 and be overvalued. I've seen it. Again, I'm not suggesting that Neptune isn't a good buy. I just haven't looked at it hard enough to draw that conclusion. But I certainly will in an upcoming update. But again, I would just be very, very cautious about looking at a stock strictly because of its price. I mean, if that's your method, if that's your methodology, that's okay. It's just probably not going to provide you a lot of winners in whatever market you decide to invest in. Now, Jamie asked me about smaller cannabis companies. And when I mean small, I mean small. And Jamie said, I hold several cannabis stocks that are doing great. But what I'm wondering is about your comments on EMHTF, GGBXF, and VLNCF. These are down now. So was it hype that held them higher at the beginning of the year? Well, it's a good question, Jamie, and I do appreciate you asking. Now, let me go through the alphabet soup here. EMHTF is Emerald Health Therapeutics. And then you have GGBXF, that is Green Grove Brands Incorporated. And then you have VLNCF, which is the Valens Company Incorporated. They're all traded over the counter, along with a lot of smaller cannabis stocks. The one thing you have to remember about over-the-counter stocks is that their volatility is even higher than cannabis companies traded on a traditional exchange, like Aurora or Canopy or Tilray or companies like that. Then you've got to factor in that cannabis stocks are already volatile plays, and you have a combination with that, plus that they're on an over-the-counter exchange like the Pink Sheets, and that spells a lot of up and downs. So while the three companies may have been doing well in the beginning of the year, their volatility would suggest that uptrend doesn't last. The same applies for a downtrend. It may not last very long. So I don't necessarily know that it's hype. I think it's just the nature of where these companies are in terms of how they're traded. They're extremely volatile companies. They don't have a lot of financials for me to really look at to dig into. So it's hard for me to suggest that there's a fundamental reason why these three companies were up big and then down. My inclination is to suggest that it's probably just the nature of the over-the-counter market. I'm very cautious about over-the-counter stocks. I realize there's a lot of cannabis stocks that are traded over the counter, and there are some very good over-the-counter stocks. I just get very hesitant just because they are very, very volatile. So just be very cautious and do your homework. And if you do have a question about any one of those in particular, let me know, and I'll be more than happy to try to dig into it. Now, finally, Lynn answered my question about the reason for investing in cannabis stocks. And I kind of want to read this because I think it speaks to the real reason why people are getting into cannabis stocks, I think. And Lynn says, it's my hope in supporting the growth of this industry that healthy companies will continue to develop new products for medical use that change people's lives, as this product has done for me. Now, let me backtrack and say that Lynn had previously mentioned a reason that he or she uses cannabis to help fight a medical condition. Now, Lynn goes on to say, I would also like to see the black market for recreational products recede and legitimate high-quality dispensaries take their place, the sooner the better. To achieve this, the industry has to become more competitive and the products must be of consistently high quality and performance. Well, Lynn, first off, I think you have hit several nails on the head here, and I do thank you for that email and for those comments. I think there's a lot of science out there that finds medical cannabis can be used to cure or subside the effects of some illnesses. And that's something that needs to be explored even more. And you're right. The cannabis black market does continue to thrive, even in states where cannabis is legal. Look at California, for example. California has a legal cannabis market, but its black market is actually coming close, if not even bigger, than its legitimate market. I don't really know of a quick solution to make that happen outside of, broad-based legalization on the federal level, which we all know is tenuous at best right now with this Congress. And yes, high-quality products are essential to the success of any cannabis business, but that takes a lot of money, and it's money that a lot of smaller cannabis companies right now just don't have. Despite the economics of it, there are companies out there that continue to test and improve their products, and that's a great thing, and it should be encouraged. But they're doing it at a cost, and that cost won't be manageable until cannabis companies are infused with new capital. That said, Lynn, thank you for your email. I sincerely hope we reach those benchmarks that you explained. And as you said, the sooner the better. That's about all for me this week. I'd like to say I love all the feedback that we're getting on YouTube as well as through our email. Remember the email address to send comments, questions, and stocks you'd like me to look at. feedback@moneyandmarkets.com. That's feedback@moneyandmarkets.com. Also, don't forget to tell me why you're interested in cannabis stocks. I'd love to hear what you guys have to say. I've got a ton of that feedback already. We're trying to tweak some things and really try to tailor the content to what you're looking for. If you're interested in listening to the Marijuana Market Update before anyone else, just make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel by hitting the subscribe button down below if you're not already, and then click that notification bell and that'll let you know when there's a new video that comes out. The same goes for our Bull and Bear podcast and our week ahead video that we put out, as well as anything else that we're cooking some new things. And by the way, if you have any ideas for maybe some new videos, we'd love to hear that too. Just email me at feedback@moneyandmarkets.com. We usually post videos on YouTube to our podcast channel about a day or so before they actually come out on moneyandmarkets.com. So if you subscribe, again, subscribe by hitting the button down below and then push the little bell and get notified. That's a good way to get the information first so you can take any action you feel like you need to take immediately. Coming up this week, we're going to actually have more on the Bull and the Bear podcast, our Money and Markets week ahead as well, so stay tuned. Also, make sure you check out moneyandmarkets.com every day for new content that provides safe and profitable investment information for you. With that, I'm Matt Clark. I'm research analyst for Money and Markets, host of the Bull and the Bear podcast. And until next time, safe trading, everybody.